This may look like a wild place, but that is because it was designed to. For centuries, the landscape and ecology have deeply impacted human culture, and human culture has in turn impacted the ecology here. Hi, I'm Isabella. As we go back through the history of Five Rivers Environmental Education Center, we can still find clues that help illuminate that relationship. Native American tribes have lived in New York State for over 13,000 years. For a long time, this was home to the Mohicans. Their territory stretched north to Saratoga, south to Dutchess and Ulster counties, east to western Massachusetts, and west to the Helderbergs. You can easily see the high Helderberg escarpment from Five Rivers. The proximity to the Helderberg escarpment and several major waterways made Five Rivers an important site for hunting and gathering. The Mohicans preferred to build their permanent settlements on terraces above floodplains, but they built their seasonal camps in clearings near creeks and rivers to hunt fish, white-tailed deer, elk, raccoon, woodchuck, turkey, and passenger pigeons, and forage for acorns, hickory nuts, and other wild plants. Tools like the stone knife, pestle, and broken arrowhead have been found here over the years. Mohicans were not the only ones drawn to this area by its natural resources. Historic maps show that the earliest residential structure in Albany County included a house built along the Vloomingkill by Adrian Bratt, possibly at the same site as the present-day farmhouse. Glass, ceramics, and other historic artifacts can still be found nearby in the Midden. Middens are important archaeological clues. They are dump sites for domestic waste found near settlements of all sizes, from single households to entire cities. Five Rivers is named after the five major waterways flowing nearby: the Hudson River, Mohawk River, Sacandaga River, Hoosick River, and Schoharie. Early European settlers used these waterways as easy trade routes for the fur trade that flourished in this area during the 17th century. Where Albany is today used to be the major trading post of Fort Orange. Fur was commonly used to make hats, coats, and other clothing. The Dutch West India Company was initially interested in New Netherlands, now New York State, because of the abundance of otter and beaver in the area. Native American and European trappers would travel up and down the Hudson and Mohawk River selling pelts, which were then shipped to Europe as part of the fur trade. Beaver pelts were highly sought after. Under their long, coarse hairs is a soft layer of fur that covers their entire body except for their feet and tails. These fine hairs cling together because of the tiny scales on their shaft. This adaptation traps in air and helps to insulate the beaver, but it can also be used to make a warm, dense, durable felt. Other fur, like otter pelts, were also used to make hats, capes, muffs, fur collars, and coats. It's easy to see how the landscape and local ecology, especially the proximity to major water ports and the abundance of beaver and otter, influenced the culture in this area, making it a major part of the fur trade. Unfortunately, beaver and otter were hunted to near extinction because of it. But thanks to conservation efforts started in the early 1900s, both have been re-established and are still living here at Five Rivers today. Many people are familiar with beaver lodges like this one. These lodges have partially or fully submerged entrances that beavers can safely enter from the water. As many as 6 to 12 beavers can live comfortably in one lodge. They are made from mud, branches, and twigs the beavers collect from ponds and riverbanks. Beavers tend to prefer areas with aspen, poplar, willow, or birch trees for both building materials and food. That makes this site a perfect spot for them. But not all beaver lodges look the same. Sometimes beavers will build their dens right into a riverbank. Often, beaver trees like this one are the only hint that a beaver bank den is nearby. Northern river otters also prefer to make their homes in dens dug into the banks of rivers and ponds and lakes. This is because they mostly eat fish, mice, and aquatic invertebrates like crabs and crayfish. You can see some fish scales and crayfish shells in this otter scat left by one of our ponds. Another reason they like to live by the water is because they're so playful. But river otters are more than just playful parts of the ecosystem. They are also an important indicator species. That means that they are indicators of the overall health of an ecosystem. Because they store toxins in their bodies, if there are too many pollutants in an area, otters will not thrive there. The fact that so many otters choose to make their homes here is a very good sign. The waterways in this region provided more than just trade routes and hunting grounds for the fur trade. Throughout the 17th and 18th century, many saw, grist, and lumber mills were built along the rivers and creeks here. Maps show mills built along Vloomkill as early as 1677. In fact, the Vloomkill is named for Peter Vinn, one of those early millers. Several Vinn properties are marked along the Vloomkill on this historic map. Peter Vinn was from the Flanders region of Belgium, so people started calling this creek Fleming's Creek, or Kill, which is Dutch for body of water. That eventually became Vloomkill or Vloomkill. Waterways also provided trade routes for agriculture. Since the 18th century, agriculture has provided the majority of income in this area. In the 1700s, most farms were small subsistence farms. But by the 1800s, many had grown into large commercial farms that shipped their produce up and down the Hudson River. Major crops included hay, cereal grains, potatoes, hops, and fruit. This remained the case well into the 20th century. By the 1930s, this land had become a part of Edward Ackerman's fruit farm. The impact the Ackerman farm had on agriculture can still be seen today. This gnarled old tree is actually one of Ackerman's old apple trees. If you keep an eye out for them, you can still see other old apple trees dotted all over Five Rivers. Some still bear fruit for the deer, birds, and insects to enjoy. Edward Ackerman left his mark in other ways as well. His signature can still be seen on the walls of one of our barns. But agriculture was not the only thing that changed the landscape and biodiversity here in the 20th century. Some of the most drastic and easily noticeable changes were made in the 1930s when New York State opened the Delmar Experimental Game Farm with the help of the Civilian Conservation Corps. Between 1933 and 1936, the CCC dammed rivers, dug out ponds, and built up buildings all over Five Rivers. As you can see on this map from the 1920s, the Vloomkill used to flow uninterrupted through this site. But just a few years later, Heron Pond and Beaver Pond were both created when the CCC dammed the kill. They were dug out by hand, and then thick clay extracted from the hillside was used to line the craters to prevent water from seeping out of the newly created ponds. Limestone blocks from the disassembled portions of the Erie Canal were used to create the dams. Four more ponds were created in what used to be farm fields. You can tell that they are artificial because they also have dams on them. Here you can even see pylons that once supported artificial nesting areas. Barracks were built to house the 200 CCC workers. There was also a post office, a recreation building, an infirmary, a mess hall, a blacksmith shop, a mechanical shop, and a woodworking shop. Some of these buildings are still in use today, like this one where we boil sap into syrup every March during mapling season. In other places, only a stone wall remains. The game farm was intended for raising ruffed grouse and other game animals like deer, geese, and mallard ducks. Believe it or not, mallard ducks were once uncommon in the Eastern Flyway during the 1930s and 40s. They live in shallow waters like ponds and streams, nest on the ground near the water, and eat aquatic insects, plants, worms, and grains. The newly created ponds at Five Rivers served as the perfect place to breed mallards and reintroduce them. Now they are one of the most common water birds in the area. Think of Five Rivers next time you see one paddling around on a pond. They also built vernal pools, like this one. Vernal pools are seasonal ponds that range in size from a small lake to even just a small puddle. They come in the spring when the snow melts and the rain starts, but by summer they are often dried up. These spots are important for amphibians like frogs and salamanders and reptiles like turtles. They are also a source of food and water for birds early in the spring. Meanwhile, a different dynamic between humans and the local ecology was developing on the fringes of the Delmar Experimental Game Farm. Clinton Bishop's official job title was conservation aide, but he and his wife had a habit of taking in injured animals, and in 1948, Clint began to display the wild animals in his care. This eventually included bears, foxes, raccoons, deer, pheasants, turkeys, and several other native animals. For years, Clint took educational exhibits, including live animals, on the road to fairs, hunting shows, and convention centers. He also welcomed the public in to see his ever-growing menagerie here on site. Today, we have very different feelings towards environmental education and conservation. Most nature enthusiasts live by the motto, "If you care, leave it there." But Clint Bishop's Wildlife Zoo allowed many people to interact with nature for the first time in their lives. This fostered a love of nature here in Delmar, which eventually resulted in Five Rivers as we know it today. Now, rather than raising game birds for sport, this site serves as an environmental education center. But, like the farmers and CCC workers before us, we still manage the land very carefully to achieve our specific goals. This is the Wildlife Habitat Incentive Program parcel, or the WIP parcel, a meadow we maintain here at Five Rivers. Each year, a portion of it is mowed down so that we can provide meadow habitat for songbirds and other wildlife like the eastern meadowlark and the bobolink. Meadows and old farm field are an ever-shrinking habitat in the Northeast, so meadow birds and wildlife rely on the efforts of places like Five Rivers. Five Rivers has also maintained bluebird boxes to encourage bluebird nesting since 1983. In other areas like this one, we've let the meadows continue to grow. Shrubs and small trees now fill former farm fields. Plants like red osier dogwood provide shelter for prey species like the eastern cottontail and the American woodcock. It's a very different, but still invaluable wildlife habitat. On the other end of the succession spectrum is the old growth forest along the Vlomenkill. These hemlocks are some of the oldest trees on the property. Visitors may find an occasional stump where we cut down a dead tree for safety, but many more dead trees far away from the trail are full of life. These are called snags. They are essential shelter for cavity nesters, like chickadees and yellow-bellied sapsuckers. A standing snag may be home to thousands of carpenter ants, who are in turn lunch for our pileated woodpeckers and their young. Like I said, this landscape was designed to be wild, but in many ways, the landscape has impacted us just as much as we have impacted it. It is a dynamic that has been playing out for centuries.
Hopefully, understanding how interconnected we all are will help us take better care of nature.